You glad to be here today?
Amen.
God's glad you're here.
Amen.
He's glad. He's smiling. He loves every one of you, and you're glad that you have obeyed his voice and come to his house. And today, we're going to worship him and give him all the praise and honor and glory that he deserves. And if you do that, God will bless us a great way. Amen?
Amen.
If you're excited, I want you to get ready. When we get through to prayer, we're going to sing, and I want you to give your best. Don't worry about anybody beside you. Give your best. And let's just raise the roof for God, okay?
Amen.
Not literally, but just raise the roof spiritually, okay? For God, okay? Father, we love you and we thank you because you're an awesome, wonderful, precious God. Thank you for the health to come back to your house. Thank you for a good mind to want to come back to your house. Thank you for a wonderful, clean heart that lets us do the things that please you. And today, God, we're going to give you our best in song and worship or whatever we do. It's going to be unto you and it's going to be great. So, God, take it the way we send it. I pray it cause you to rise from your rest and be blessed beyond measure today because your children love you that much. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. How many of you glad to be in the house of the Lord today?
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's all do this. We got to practice. Everybody do this. It works. Smile. Let's be happy to be in God's house today. Today's the day. Amen. Today's the day for rejoicing. Today's the day for salvation. Today's just the day to be today. Amen. Amen.
I'm reaching back. today is the day for that. Amen. Every day we wake up and have another day with the Lord is the day. Amen. It's the day to turn over our fears, our sorrows, our doubts, our worries, everything over to Him, because it's just being in His presence that's the most wonderful thing on earth. Amen. We're going to sing Shout to the Lord. I love this song. It says, Lord, there's just none like you. Do you believe that? Amen. He can move mountains. Amen. He can cross seas. Yes. He can walk on water. Amen. He can heal you. Yes. Any of y'all have a best friend like that? No, because He's the only one. Amen? God's the only one. So let's shout to the Lord this morning and let Him just know how much we love, honor, and appreciate Him today. Amen? So I wanted to do it again today because I felt like Wednesday night you were relearning it and you weren't really listening and understanding the words to it. So I feel like you know it now. And I really want you, when we get to the verses, I've asked Nan to sing the verses, and I really want you to listen to them, because this song means so, it's meant so much to me just this week. Because, guys, when we don't have anything else, we have Jesus. We always have Jesus. You know, and it's been a tough week physically, but I've just stood on the name of Jesus this week. And I have just took my heels and my shoes, and I have just stomped them in Satan's heels. And I said, you know what? Not today, Satan, right? Because when we're in the presence of God, all of our troubles just fade away, right? If we want them to. We have to surrender to him. And that's what this song is all about. It's just in the presence of Jehovah. God Almighty, he's our Prince of Peace. Think back to the night of the tornado. Did we have peace? We panicked. I mean, we didn't panic. You know, everybody, you know, we just had this peace. I mean, at least I did. You know, like, you knew something was wrong, but you knew you were protected. You know, you knew you were in God's house. And that's what it says. Troubles vanish. Hearts are mended simply just in the presence of our King. Amen.
Going to just obey God real quick before we go any farther with this song. Jimmy, need you to come in. God made a promise in his word for every child of God. And it's an open-end promise. He just made it. Anybody can accept it with any condition in your life. God said, my grace is sufficient. Now, I don't know if you know what that means or not, honestly. I don't know if you know. It's being made real to me. Paul said, I have learned to be content. I am learning about God's grace. And God's grace comes in a lot of different ways. In our healing process, his grace comes in. But it's in that learning process where I have learned, from the time where I start to I learn, it's in that gray area there where grace is sufficient. You don't have it until you get what I promised. There's a gray area. My grace is sufficient. God told me, 5 months ago about my surgery. He said, when he got through telling me what to do, then he said, my grace is sufficient. And I said, okay. He said, I told Paul that I wasn't going to heal him, but my grace is sufficient. Now, Paul lived his life waiting for that promise of healing. And God said, until you get it. And as far as we know, he never got it on this earth. We know he got it immediately in heaven. So my grace in the gray area. There are some of you this morning that are hurting. And I know that with all my heart. I see it. I know it. But I want you to know this morning, God's grace is sufficient. It should not. Turn me on here.
All right. It should not hinder your worship. If you believe his grace is sufficient, that means whenever a pain comes, whatever it is, you remind yourself, my grace is sufficient. No matter how you feel physically, remind yourself, my grace is sufficient. I've prayed. We're going to believe, but until then, God's grace will hold us, will keep us, will supply to us, get us through any pain, get us through any situation, because His grace is sufficient. I want to pray a prayer this morning. And whatever's going on in your heart, in your mind, in your body, I want you to be able to release it this morning. God, I'm hurting, but Your grace is sufficient. God, I got a problem, but Your grace is sufficient. And I'm going to depend on You, God. Your grace is the medicine that I need spiritually until I get to the point where I don't have to take it anymore. Your grace is sufficient. Now, if you've got a real problem this morning, if you're suffering from anything, I want you to let this prayer be for you, and I want you to accept it. This song is perfect for what we're fixing to do. After we get through praying, this song is in the presence of the Lord. I want you to rejoice. I want you to worship God. As Nan sang those verses, as we sang the chorus, worship God, because in His presence, His grace is sufficient. And let everything else go. Nothing is going to hinder me from worshiping God, because He told me His grace would be sufficient. That means I can do anything through Him in the name of Jesus Christ. Now I want you to agree with me. I'm praying for your head. Just agree with me. My grace is sufficient. Whatever He needs, whatever He wants you to do. And with the headache, I'll sing the greatest I've ever sung in my life. Without the headache, I'll sing the greatest I've ever sung. It makes no difference. His grace. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I speak healing on this body this morning. Through You, Lord, and Your name. And in the precious name of Jesus Christ, we accept Your word that if we pray in faith, believing, all things are possible. Now, God, You said until that time, Your grace is sufficient. It is there to minister. It is there to fill the gap. It is there to ease my pain. It is there to spur me to worship and spur me to praise. Your grace is sufficient. You're greater, God, than my pain. You're greater than my disease. You're greater than my heartache. You're greater than anything in my life. And I accept Your praise, and I accept Your worship, and I accept Your grace. And God, I am free, I am healed, and I will worship You and give You my best this day, because You deserve it, and I believe Your word. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In the presence of God, there is peace and there is rest. I love You, Father. I love You, Father. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I thank You for touching everybody. I thank You for lifting every spirit. I thank You because You're an awesome God. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Thank You, Jesus. Now sing under the anointing. Sing under the anointing now. Amen.
Talk of war with me. All day long I struggle for answers that I need. But then I come into His presence, and all my questions become clear. Sacred moment. place to find the answer in the hour of distress. Now there's never any reason for you to give up in despair. Just slip away and breathe His name. He will surely
today, that we can be in the presence of Jehovah, Lord God Almighty, King of kings and Lord of lords, our Master, our Savior, our ruler, our protector, our provider, our love. God, I thank you today that you're not only our King, but you're our friend. I thank you that your word says that your grace is sufficient. And that, God, you have shown us a truth today. That in between the beginning and the end, your faith works mighty miracles. I'm grateful, God. Surely grateful that you protected us from the storm.
But God, I'm grateful that you kept this house intact. And God, I would say this morning that we love you. We're depending on you. But God, I would also today want to take time to speak to our enemy. And I would say to him, devil, you're a roaring lion. And you have no claws and no teeth. You roared outside of our church, but you couldn't come in. You didn't have that power. You're roaring in this virus. You're roaring and people are listening. But you have no claws. You have no teeth. You can touch the body, but you not touch our soul. Devil, our country is in chaos. You have spread your filthy lies. And those who are in darkness have believed it. But there is a remnant of God's people. And that remnant through the power of God is greater than all the people in the world put together against it. You have brought division in our government. But I want you to know, devil, that the government is under God's control. He said there would be things we wouldn't understand, but to have faith and trust, and I do. So Satan, today I'm just simply saying to you, you're trying very hard because you know your time is short because God is coming soon. But I'm here to tell you, you lose again. And Satan, I thank you for allowing our people to see just what power you think you have. Because through your weakness, we saw the greatness and the strength of God. Now, Satan, I'll also put you on notice. I'm claiming every soul in this church. Every soul that's not here, I'm claiming they will be back in your house, in God's house, not your house. I'm claiming that every one of them will come back, that their eyes will be open to the blindness that you've placed upon them, and they will see the truth that you're a liar and that you cannot harm and you cannot hurt God's people. And I claim everyone back in the house of God, and I claim them for the kingdom of God. And Father, I thank you today that you heard our prayer. We stand on your word. We stand on your strength. God is Lord. He is master. He is king. He is friend. And we are his children. Therefore, we have everything that we can hope or desire in Jesus' name. God, bless what we do today. Bless every person in here. And let us rejoice in the name of Jesus Christ, because the word is coming where Satan thought he could stop it. The word is coming, and we thank you for it. I love you. I praise you. And God, to thee be all honor and glory. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. 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 I will tell you this morning, with a thankful heart, that I thank God for our praise team. I thank God for our wonderful musicians. I thank him for our sound booth people. I thank him for our IT department, for all the work they've done to make this comfortable for you. To God be the glory. Amen. Everything that's been done has been done to let the devil see that we are marching on. Amen. For those who set the chairs up, thank God. For those who keep them clean and straight, thank God. for those who spray to protect us from the virus. No, we got it. Thank God. We're showing the devil we're marching on. I will not be deterred. I will not stop. I will not back up. I will not rest. I'm going forward. And I thank God for everything that's being done to make this just as easy and just as simple as possible, because the more we do that, the more the devil hates it. Amen. And I want you to pray with me every day. Those of you who have a prayer life and will do it, we're claiming every soul that will be in church. We're claiming them. They're going to be back in church. We're claiming it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I want you to pray that. I want you to believe that with me. Hallelujah. Open your Bible to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. It's good to see all you here today. I'm thankful for you too. I really am. I love all of you. This is God's house, and God is good, and God wants his people to receive everything he has for them. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Now, you're going to have to put on your smart hat this morning. Those of you who have one, if you don't have one, sit close to somebody that does and share with them. I want you to follow me in the scripture and what I'm going to tell you, because you got to stay close and you got to stay with me. If you do, God will show you something great this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient or necessary. And all things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of anything. Amen. Father, a wonderful scripture. Now, speak through me so everybody can hear it and understand it. Each word is important. Show us the meaning and how it affects us. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul was having a time with some of his believers there in the Corinthian church. And they had all kind of rules and regulations there from the government and from priests and sinful leaders. They had bound them with a lot of laws. And when Jesus came and died on Calvary, he died to set us free. And we're free from the law. The law that was binding his people. We're free from that. And now we are bound by the law of God. Amen. But they were having a hard time. They couldn't. Well, you know, if I can't eat this because they said that's unholy, so I can't eat that. I can't go here because they said you can't. I can't. And I got to do this because they say if I'm a Christian, I've got to do. There were all kind of laws out there, and Paul was having a hard time with it. So he's trying to explain to them now his understanding of the law in their relationship with being born again in Christ. And he says, all things are lawful unto me. All things. But you have to understand, Paul is not saying, so I can go out and drink, and I can go out and do drugs, and I can go out and do porn, I can go out and have sexual sins, I can, you know, because it's all legal unto me, I can do it. That's not what he's saying. Paul is saying, as a born-again child of God who has been set free from the world, I now in Christ know that all things are legal for me. Anything that is of God, I can do. Anything. But now remember, they're having a problem with false doctrine. So Paul is saying, anything that's of God, I can do. All things are lawful unto me. I have the right to do them as a born-again child of God. But all things are not expedient. And he's saying here, all things are not necessary. All things are not helpful unto me. There are some things I don't need to do, but I have the freedom to do all of them. So then he says it again. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any of them. Now this is a real saying. It's a hard saying, but you got to think with me. Paul says, I've been saved. Therefore, I have been set free from the world. There are no restraints on me by the world, but I've got to put restraints on myself. All things are legal to me, but not all things are necessary for me. Now, I believe that. And I've said it to you many times since I have been in the ministry. I have had several pastors I've been under in my life. And they were all different. And I would look at them and I would, and some of them I'd say, you know, I like that. And then I'd see them do something, I'd say, you know, I got a problem with that. And you just do that through life and you watch them. So then I've got to figure out what God wants me to be. What is my responsibility? And God told me early on that my responsibility is, number one, is to be a Christian and live a Christian life. Then I have got to act as I live the part of a Christian. I'm your leader. So I've got to lead you into the Word of God and the will of God and the way of God. I've got to lead you there. I can't send you there. I've got to, as a shepherd, go before you and lead you there. I've got to live as every one of the fruits of the Spirit are within me. I've got to begin to let those things come forth to you. I've got to give them to you. Love, joy, peace, goodness, kindness, understanding, meekness, gentleness. I've got to let that be a part of my life, and I've got to give that to you. I got to let you say, that's what I want. That's what I see. But see, it goes farther than that. My dress, I think, ought to represent Jesus Christ. I do. Now, it doesn't matter what you think about that, because I'm talking about me. I was brought up by my mother and dad that you didn't wear dirty clothes to church. You didn't wear church. You didn't wear clothes with holes in the. You didn't wear pants with holes in the legs either. You didn't do that. Mother put a patch on them if we got a hole in them. Amen. And we were taught that you didn't wear shorts in church. This is the way I was brought up. This has nothing to do with you. I'm talking about me. We didn't go to dances. We didn't go to picture show. Me and David know that. I never will forget, David got old enough to drive, and I thought I had to go everywhere he went. So one night, David says, come on, we're going to go somewhere. I said, all right. So we get in the car, and we go, and he pulls up to the old movie downtown. I said, what are you doing? He said, we're going to the movies. I said, I'm not going to the movies. He said, oh, yeah, we're going to the movies. I said, I'm not going to the movies. We stood there, and we argued for a moment. There was a drugstore on the corner. He went down to the drugstore and bought me a funny book, brought it back and gave it to me. He said, I'll be back after a while. Now, I was brought up strict. My mother and dad said it. I believed it. And I tried to do what they said. I didn't always do it, but I tried to do what they said. But they taught me, you dress nice. You dress nice. Well, things have changed. Boy, have they changed. Amen. And today we have different interpretation of morals. We don't have different morals. They're still there. We've got different interpretations of them. And as we interpret them, I have to learn to adjust and to adapt. It is hard. It's hard for me to stand up here and have a short-sleeved shirt on and dungarees and tennis shoes. I see it on TV. That's them. Okay, do it. I got a problem with it. That's me. That's my opinion. It has nothing to do with anybody else. You see, that's what Paul's saying. He says, I can do anything under the law of God. Do anything. But not everything is necessary, expedient. So I can wear shorts to church if I want to. But I'm not going to do it. See? The other day, Steph and I were uptown somewhere.
and we come out of a grocery store, and there was a middle-aged man like me. He'd walked out, and he had a pair of shorts on, and had a pair of like flip-flops and a shirt. And I said, "Steph, I wish I could dress like that." She said, "You can." She says, "You can." But see, I can't do that because I represent the church out there too. And it's just this thing I've got. It doesn't make it right. I'm telling you, it's me. And this is what Paul's trying to tell them. He said, "I know what y'all believe. I can see it. Some of you in here are going to wear shorts to church no matter what I say. You're going to wear pants with holes in them no matter what I say. You're not going to wear a tie. You're not going to wear a coat. You're not going to dress up nice no matter what I say. I understand that. It doesn't make you a sinner. It doesn't make me a Christian. I have my own life to live." Right. And Jesus said to me, "Dan, you can do anything you want to legally, anything you want to, but just understand there's some things that's not necessary for you to do." So I have to try to figure out then, God, what is it that I can do and what is it I can't do? Because I got to always question myself. Mm-hmm. I've got a high standard of myself and my interpretation more. I got a high standard because, see, not only do I represent God in everything I do, I represent my mother and daddy. I represent them. And I'm not going to dishonor my mother and daddy. I tell you, I'm not going to do it. My girls, they have the same responsibility to honor their father and their mother. Same responsibility. But see, we've lost something in there. And we think that just because it's okay to do it, we can do it. But Paul said, "No, you got to understand. I can do all things, but not all things are necessary for me to do." Now, what happens when you and I get in trouble? Now keep the thought I just gave you. Now, let's switch a minute. What happens when you and I get in trouble? What happens when our world is turned upside down? What happens when somebody hurts us or something hurts us, something devastates us, and in our spiritual life, we get in trouble? What happens then? How do we act? What do we do? Paul said, "Well, I can do anything. Because as long as it's legal, I can do it. But all things that I can do aren't the right thing to do." So how do you respond when trouble comes in your life? What do you do? And what do you do according to the Word of God? What does God want you to do? And what do you do in relationship to that? Again, all things are lawful unto me, but not all things are what I should do. In the times that I was in youth ministry, and Dawson is leading a youth group right now there in Statesboro, and he called me the other night, Wednesday night. He called me Wednesday night, and he was on the way home, and he said, "Well, Poppy," he said, I did the group tonight." I said, "Good." I said, "What'd you teach on?" He told me. He said, "After we got through with church," he said, "some of them invited me out, and they wanted me to go to I'm sure it was a chicken house." And he said, "I went with them." And I said, "Well, that's good." He said, "Yeah." He said, "Papa and I, they were high school seniors." And he said, "You know, they're high school seniors. You know, they're funny, and they're this and they're that." And that tickled me on the inside because we got a guy just getting out of high school. So he went on, and then I said, "Well, Dawson," I said, "there's a rule that Paul gave in his word." And Paul said, "I became all things to all people so I could reach them with the gospel of Jesus Christ." I said, "That was a principle I lived by as a youth minister." And I said, whenever you go out with them and they invite you out, that's a good thing because you got to mix with them. And I said, "Then while you're out there, you got to represent Christ. And if they want to laugh, you laugh with them. They tell a silly joke and they laugh, you laugh with them. You know, you want to get on their level. You got to talk to them." And I said, "If you'll give them what they want, then when you turn around and get in class, they'll give you what you want. And that is to listen to what you got to say. But you got to mingle, you got to mix. But you don't go over that. You don't go over to something that's not right. See, I can do all things, but there are some things I shouldn't do. Because it's not good. Not that it's a sin,
But it's going to lead somebody wrong or it's going to do something wrong, so I got to know what the difference is. So we got to understand that in the situations that we face in our spiritual lives, there are times that we cry. Big boys do cry. Old men do cry. Middle-aged men like me do cry. High school seniors do cry. Because things don't go right always in our lives. So it's okay to cry. How do you handle those situations? What do you do with them? See, Paul says, I know I can cry, but there are certain things I'm not going to do. And he said, you got to know the difference. I'm not going to lash out at them. I'm not going to hurt somebody. I'm not going to say something evil or say something bad because I want to do what God wants me to do. So now I want to be Superman. Have you ever thought about being Superman? Oh, I have. What do you, Susie, you Supergirl? Is that what you dream about being, Supergirl or Wonder Woman? Nah. Superman. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But my weakness is that kryptonite. Yeah? It's always out there, that sin. But I'm Superman. But you know what? When Superman was not Superman, who was he? Clark Kent. And he wore glasses. A newspaper man. See, some of us have never gotten to the point of being Superman. We're still Clark Kent. We've not transformed into what God wants us to be. We're still that guy that walks around everybody else and wearing glasses on, and we look like just like everybody else. There's no difference in us whatsoever. But when I do that thing and I do my twist, and I become Superman, and I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. See, that's where God wants us. Why aren't we there? Why is it that we're content just being, you know, Clark Kent in our lives and not being Superman? Because we haven't learned. Now, let's look at this scripture again. He says, I can do all things, but not all things are necessary. So Paul says, number one, when I get in trouble, I want to learn how to rejoice. I can do all things. That's freedom. And I know there's some things I'm not going to do. That's freedom. It's called wisdom. So no matter what I'm facing, I've learned to rejoice. I'm going to be happy. Why? Because I can do all things. And I'm going to tell you something. There were times when me and David grew up that we'd get in a fight. Literally, we were fighting one day at a basketball court. We were fighting. Greg was there. We were fighting. All of a sudden, I heard a noise of loot, and here comes Mama. Halfway out there, she reached down and picked up a lead pipe. She did. And she got out where we were, and she was looking up like this, but we automatically quit fighting. We knew. See, that's what God is. I could have hit him. He could have hit me, but what would that have done? Spiritually, in our lives, what would that have done? See, we do that spiritually. Things happen to us and we react. And then we think we've done the right thing. Well, he said it first. Well, she did it first. It's okay. You know, we say all these crazy things. But we haven't learned that whatever we're going through, rejoice, be a Christian. I could knock his block off because he did it to me first. But that's not the right thing to do. Do unto others you'd have them do unto you. That, we don't practice that anymore. But Paul said, I can do all things, but some things I'm not going to do. As Christians, we've got to realize there are some things we have the right to do, but we don't need to do them because we're giving a bad example to other people. So we got to learn to rejoice. Wherever I am, whatever I'm doing, whatever God puts me in, I'm going to learn to rejoice because as long as I'm rejoicing, that means I have the freedom to hit him. I also have the freedom to not hit him. And when I choose the freedom of not hitting him, I have won a moral victory in my life. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And now I'm going to rejoice. That's what Paul said. Joy in Christ, because Christ is bigger than anything in our life. Paul, whenever Paul was in the ministry, on that boat, when it was about to sink, Paul was down the bottom of the boat praying for God to help him. And Paul, when 2 weeks are up and Paul comes up on top and they don't know what to do, he just says, hey, don't worry about it. Just rejoice. God said, everything's going to be okay. If you'll just do what I tell you to do, God's going to bless us. No person is going to die. We all going to be good. See, rejoicing. Or Paul could have gone nuts, you know, and do all this. And Stephanie said a while ago, you know, the other day in the storm, we were calm. And I admire y'all for that. I've told several people, I said, the church just got calm. I said, we were very quiet. We sang some songs. We prayed a prayer. And I said, everything I asked them to do, they did. I said, there was no big panic. See, that's what God wants. We could go nuts and we could scream and holler and cry and weep and so on. But also, God says, I'm with you. It's okay. We should have been rejoicing, which in the spirit, we were in one way or another. We were rejoicing that God had not let the building come down, even though we didn't know what had happened. See, that's what God says. You've got the right to do a lot of things, but rejoice in Him. Next, He says, we've got to learn to trust Him. Now, I can do all things, but not all things are the thing for me to do. So we've got to learn to trust God. What's the best thing? What's God wants us to do? The knowledge of God's Word is our strength. The more we know about the Word, the stronger we're going to be. The knowledge of His Word. What does God's Word say? Lo, I'm with you always. So I can do whatever I want to do because God's with me and I have a legal right to do it. No, what God says is I want you to please me. I want you to act like a Christian. I want people to see you there. It doesn't matter if you go down. It doesn't matter if you fail in human eyes. That doesn't make a bit of difference. You've won in my eyes. And that's all I want. Sometimes we're going to stand tall for Christ. Sometimes we're going to be right down there, but we're still praising God. I found that whatever situation I'm in, I'm content. Why? Because I trust God. And whether I have everything I want, I trust God. Whether I'm sick unto death, I trust God. Whether I have great health, I trust God. Why? I rejoice because I know everything I have and everything that I am comes from a God that loves me. And I want to please Him with everything that I do. We got to learn to pour our hearts out to Him. I can do all things. But not everything's necessary. Not everything's good for God. So I got to learn to pray, say, okay, God, what's best? What's best? God, how should I dress? God, where should I go? What can I do? If you were here, what would you do? I've got to learn to trust God because my first instinct many times is the devil telling us, do this. It's the devil doing this. That's our first instinct. That's why we lash out and then we say, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to do that. See, because that first reaction, that's usually the devil pushing us. So we got to stop and pray. God, what would you have me to do? See, that ability for us to stand still and know that I am God, stand still. In the midst of a storm, stand still. Because at some point I'm going to say, be still, wind. So stand still and ask me. I can do all things. But not all things are what I should do, and I've got to know the difference. I've got to let God show me and let God talk to me. I've got to pour my heart out to God. The centurion came to God one day, and he says, listen, I got a servant girl. She's sick, and I know if you'll just speak the word, she'll be healed. See, we got to understand who God is. Well, I don't need you to come to her. I don't need you to touch her. I don't need you to do it. Speak the word because I know who you are. We got to know God that way. God, this sickness I'm going through, this pain I'm going through, this suffering I'm going through, this marital problems I'm going through, whatever it is, God, I know you're in control of it, and I'm just asking you to speak to it in my life. Until then, your grace is sufficient. Amen. And we go on. We've got to learn to get there with God. There are some things we can do. There are some things we cannot do. We've got to learn, what is the effect upon me if I do it? What's the effect upon me if I do something I shouldn't do? How does it affect me? We got to know how that same thing is going to affect my freedom. If I have the freedom to do anything, if God said, here it is. Take, for instance, food. If you're on a diet, and there's a table prepared for you, and it's got everything in the world on it you can imagine, every kind of meat, every kind of potato, every kind of vegetable. I mean, it's got everything except liver on it, and it's a beautiful place. And now you have the ability to eat anything on that table. You have the ability. You have the right. And you're on a diet. But because the table is there, we're going to eat anything we want as much as we want because we'll go out later and work it off. See? But God says, listen, I spread a table before you and everything on there, you can have anything you want, but not all things are good for your spiritual diet. So we go there and we pick things out that will help us spiritually. There are certain things that T-bone steak may not help me spiritually. It may next time, but not this time. You see, that salad there, but there are times that salad is what I need. And if I don't eat the salad and I eat the meat, then see, I've lost something because I did not get what I needed spiritually in my life. There's a table spread before us spiritually. We've got to learn how to eat according to the spiritual diet that God wants us on. And we've got to learn to understand our freedom. We have a freedom to eat anything on that table. But, buddy, it feels good afterwards when you know you've eaten the right thing. You have the freedom to eat. You have the freedom not to eat. You had the freedom to eat everything. You had the freedom to eat some things. And when you use that freedom, not only do you feel good afterwards, but it makes God feel good that he has given you the power and you've used it to glorify him. All things are legal to me, but I don't do all of them because they're all not necessary. And then we've got to learn to give God our hurts. Now, if all things are necessary, if all things are legal, then what we're going through spiritually, we've got to learn that if I want God's will and I want to do it God's way, I've got to go to him and give him my hurts. Because as long as I have them, the devil's tempting me to do something I shouldn't do. So I got to learn to give it to God and trust God as I give it to him, because it's going to have an effect not only on me, but it's going to have an effect on the people around me, and it's going to have an effect on God. I can't pretend like nothing is going on. Listen, when I wake up in the morning and I've got pains, there's no sense in me trying to tell me, I don't have no pain. I'm lying. God, I got pain. But your grace is sufficient. Help me today. Amen. Wherever I go, whatever I do, give me strength to do it. And it may mean that I have to go there and sit down the whole time. But God, give me the strength to sit. Amen. Give me the strength to stand. Whatever you give me, God, let me use it. If God gives you strength to stand and you sit down, you're in trouble. Yeah. Well, it's not wrong. It's not a sin to sit down. No, it's not a sin. But when God gives you strength to stand and you don't do it, you're losing something. Yeah. See, we got to figure this out in our life. I can do anything. I can sit. I'm fine. I can stay home and watch it on TV. Ain't no problem. And that's right. But there's some things that's not right. And even though you can sit there and watch it on TV, when you need to be in God's house, you're wrong by watching it on TV. See, we got to learn this. There are sometimes you need to be home. So you got to figure it out. So you give God your cares, you give God your concerns, you give God your hurts, and you release them to him and say, God, help me today to go and do like you want me to do, because I want more than anything else to please you. I want your will to be my will, and I want your way to be my way. When we realize really how weak we are, then we can depend on God. See how weak we are and how much we need to grow. It's our race and our experience. That's what Philippians says. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. What are you addicted to? Now, I'm going to close out, but I want you to think about this. Last part of this verse, Paul said, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient, necessary. All things are lawful unto me, but I will not be brought under the power of any of it. Now, there's where Paul gets the victory. I can do all things, but I'll not be brought under the power of it. What kind of things is Paul talking about? I wrote some stuff down. If this affects any of you, you know I love you. We can get addicted to anything. I'll not be under the bondage of anything. TV. Yeah. iPads. You hardly see a young person without an iPad or a phone everywhere you go. Addicted. Porn. How many Christian people are addicted to it? They do it and nobody sees it and nobody knows it. So you're not hurting anybody. No, you're hurting yourself tremendously. And you're hurting God. Coffee.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I can't operate until I get that first cup of coffee in the morning. Boy, that's a great witness to God, isn't it? I don't need God first thing in the morning. I need that cup of coffee. That's a great witness. Okay. Calm back down. Alcohol. They had that deacon's window at the store so you can drive around to the back and get your alcohol and nobody see it. That's called a deacon's window. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How about drugs? How many people, good Christian people, are taking drugs that are prescribed to them, but they're hooked on them? Mm-hmm. See, that's wrong. How about food? Anybody hooked on food? Have you gotten to the point where you can take it or you can leave it? Really? God told me, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago to start eating one meal a day. And no problem whatsoever. And I can go for days without eating a meal. It's just not a necessity in my life. And when the devil tries to say, well, you know, you're not getting the nutrients, you're not getting this, you're not getting that, I said, well, fine. I'm just doing what God said. He told me, he said, I fed the Hebrew children. I had Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel. I fed them. He said, don't worry about it. And I don't. But how many people are addicted to food? You've got to eat 3 times a day. Not because you're hungry. You got to eat. You got to eat. See, that's addictive. Paul says, look, I can do all things. Nothing wrong with eating, but I'm not going to be a prisoner or bound by anything. How about in the end here, Facebook? Anybody bound by Facebook? None of us in here, I'm sure, I understand that. But when you spend more time doing Facebook than you do reading God's word, you're bound by something that you shouldn't be bound by. Is Facebook a sin? Nope. It's okay to do it. As long as you keep it in God's realm, it's okay to do it. But when you become addicted to it, it's wrong. I don't care it's wrong. It's wrong. Now, these are truths that Paul's trying to teach us. I can do all things, but not all things are necessary. Not all things are good for me and my spiritual growth. So I've got to be careful, and I've got to choose, and I've got to choose and do it God's way. What do you have this morning in your life that you're addicted to, that you don't need? I'm not talking about it being a sin, but anything that you're addicted to, you become a slave to it. And when you become a slave to anything, you care more for it than you do for God and His Word. Yeah. But you'll tell me you love God, and I know you do. But the point is, we can love God. See, you can come up to me and you can tell me you love me. And we can hug next, and you can go outside the door and you can talk about me. I mean, that's the way it works, and I fully understand that. So, you know, we can tell God we love Him, but then when we're doing these things and we're being bound by other things that don't truly lift up God, then what are we telling God? I love you, but I'm going to serve you, but God, your will is my will, but. And see, we throw that in there because we're going to do these little things because we got to. We got to go. We got to eat. We got to do this. We got to do that. We got to on some things, but does it become excess? If I were to call today and tell every one of you, I want us to go on a fast for 3 days, and the only thing you can do is drink water. My belief may be short, but I don't think I'd get many people in here that say, I'll do it. Because the first thing the devil tells you can't go 3 days without food. He is a liar, and he is the father of lies. You can do anything that you want to do for Christ if you make up your mind you're going to do it. But you got to make up your mind, because this thing becomes our enemy. I'm going to do it, then the devil comes here. You got to eat. You got to do. You got to have that. See, and he gets in our minds, and then our mind takes over, and we do this. It's not a sin, but we're bound by it, and it's going to lead to a sin. And we have to be careful. Is it God first in your life? You got to make that choice. It cannot be other things first and God second. It's got to be God first always. And church, if we can ever get a hold of that, I have learned that whatever state I'm in, to be content. You can do anything you want to do for Christ if you make up your mind. Anything. 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 If you just make up your mind. You can do anything. There is no limit to doing God's work. If you just make up your mind, you're going to do it. We make up our mind. We're going to have church. Don't matter what he did down there. So God helped us have a building. We can have church. Well, I said, let's make it simple. Let's don't move all this stuff down here right now. Let's just make it simple. You know, let's just get in there. I don't need the worries right now. I got enough. Let's just make it simple. And I told Debbie, make it simple. What'd they do? They come down here and set their stuff up. Becky and all the IT department came in here and set their stuff up. Why? Because they want to glorify God. And we're not going to let the devil rule our lives. We didn't have to do all that. They certainly didn't have to do that because I asked them to make it simple. I didn't even say we had to do this up here. See, if somebody wanted to show the devil I'm serious about what I'm doing and I'm going to do everything God wants me to do because I know we can do it. May be hard, maybe take some time, may make it, but we're going to do it. That's what you got to say in your Christian life. I'm going to do it. I don't care what the devil says. I'm going to do it. And we march on, and we continue to have church, and we're glorifying God with everything. Oh, they wanted to bring, I said, you don't have to do this. You don't have to bring the drums down here. You saw Joy playing the drums this morning, didn't you? Because they want to do it. They want to do their best for God, and I'm thankful for all of them. Do you want to do the same? But then take those things that's binding you and have you bound and get rid of them. Say, no, I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm going to begin to do it God's way. Do that and see what God does with you, okay? All things are legal to me. But not all things are necessary. I'm going to change the way I dress. I'm going to glorify God. I'm going to change where I sit if that's necessary so I can hear the word of God. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that because I want God to be glorified with everything I do. Try it and see what happens. I'm going to love my wife. I'm going to love my husband like I never have before. You can do that. Well, they're not good. That's just your opinion. They are good. Find it in them. They are good. Could you imagine what we could do? I'm going to love my pastor. Oh, do you know what that would do if you did that? I'd preach up a storm. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. Wow. Okay. Father, I love you, and I thank you for a wonderful day, and I thank you for a blessed day. I thank you for your word, God. It's a hard word, but God, it's a word that can help us become better for you. That's what it's all about. We can't skip the hard words in the Bible. All the words are there. All of them are for us, and all of them for us to learn better how to glorify you. I thank you for the privilege of standing here and speaking truth. I thank you, God, that somebody's not stopping me or trying to stop me, that the word's just coming forth freely. And I thank you because you're moving among our people. And I thank you for all they've done to make this a good church and to make this a place where we're going to continue to worship God and we're going to continue to show the devil he has no control, no authority, and no place in this building whatsoever except under our feet. And we will grind him and grind him and grind him as we march forward for God. Teach us what we should and shouldn't do and how to do it and trust you and say, God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I'm going to... And then let us fill that blank in and do it. I love you and I thank you and I praise you. And we'll see you in Jesus' name. Amen.